Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be His kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you your secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to God's people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, in Christ you have revealed your glory among the nations. Preserve the works of your mercy, that your church throughout the world may persevere with steadfast faith in the confession of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated for the reading of Holy Scripture.
A reading from Isaiah. Surely he has borne our infirmities and carried our diseases. Yet we accounted him stricken, struck down by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole, and by his bruises we are healed. All we, like sheep, have gone astray. We have all turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. By a perversion of justice he was taken away. Who could have imagined his future? For he was cut off from the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people. They made his grave with the wicked and his tomb with the rich, although he had done no violence and there was no deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him with pain. When you make his life an offering for sin, he shall see his offspring and shall prolong his days. Through him the will of the Lord shall prosper. Out of his anguish he shall see light. He shall find satisfaction through his knowledge. The righteous one, my servant, shall make many righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore I will allot him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out himself to death and was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Today's psalm is Psalm 91. We'll read it responsively by half verse. Because you have made the Lord your refuge, there shall no evil happen to you. For for he shall give his angels charge over you. They shall bear you in their hands. You shall tread upon the lion and adder. Because he is bound to me in love, therefore will I deliver him. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. With long life will I satisfy him. A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Every high priest chosen from among mortals is put in charge of things pertaining to God on their behalf, to offer gifts and sacrifices for sins. He is able to deal gently with the ignorant and wayward, since he himself is subject to weakness. And because of this, he must offer sacrifice for his own sins, as well as for those of the people. And one does not presume to take this honor, but takes it only when called by God, just as Aaron was. So also Christ did not glorify himself in becoming a high priest, but was appointed by the one who said to him, "You are my son, today I have begotten you," as he says also in another place, "You are a priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek." In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverent submission. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered, and having been made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him, having been designated by God a high priest according to the order of Melchizedek. The word of the Lord.
Savior Jesus Christ, according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came forward to Jesus and said to him, "Teacher, We want you to do for us whatever we ask of you. And he said to them, what is it you want me to do for you? And they said to him, grant us to sit one at your right hand and one at your left in your glory. But Jesus said to them, you do not know what you are asking. Are you able to drink the cup that I drink, or be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with? They replied, we are able. Then Jesus said to them, the cup that I drink, you will drink. And with the baptism with which I am baptized, you will be baptized. But to sit at my right hand or at my left is not mine to grant, but it is for those for whom it has been prepared. When the 10 heard this, they began to be angry with James and John. So Jesus called them and said to them, you know that among the Gentiles, those whom they recognize as their rulers lord it over them, and their great ones are tyrants over them. But it is not so among you. But whoever wishes to become great among you must be your servant, and whoever wishes to be first among you must be slave of all. For the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord.
May I speak in the name of one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Our readings this morning bring us almost to a Good Friday moment. We have that amazing and beautiful passage of the suffering servant in Isaiah. Surely he has borne our infirmities and carried our diseases, oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. It's one of the most compelling and beautiful passages that we read and reflect on as Christians looking back over time from the perspective of Christ's sacrifice for us. And then, of course, the Hebrew reading invites us to ponder, like, once again, you are my son, today I have begotten you, but you are the one who will also suffer. These are beautiful readings and set us in a very different place or time in our liturgical year. And then we come to the Gospel, where James and John, the sons of Zebedee, ask Jesus a serious question. As I reflected on this serious question, I thought, this is very interesting. They clearly misunderstood what Jesus meant by kingdom. Context is everything. They were subject to the Roman Empire. They had in the living memory of the Hebrew people the captivity in Babylon, the Assyrians, and all of the other kinds of dominant forces throughout the Middle East at that time. And so they thought, even though Jesus had predicted his passion in this gospel narrative of Mark twice now, they still were thinking kingdom thoughts, kingdom in their context. And then I thought, well, James and John, they do get a bad rap for this particular passage. And it really is out of misunderstanding. And if you've ever had anything to do with 4 and 5 year olds, as I did yesterday watching a spectacular soccer game, is all I can say, you know, if you at school with the little preschool and kindergarten folk, want to be the line leader, right? You want to lead the group. And when you're not the line leader, well, you could be the doorkeeper. You know, you can hold the door. Well, James and John really seemed to have that complex. They hadn't quite gotten over that they wanted to be the line leaders when they got to the kingdom. but they fully misunderstood what the kingdom of God was about. And it's also a little bit fun to think about the 10 who got mad at the 2 who were trying to get in front of the line. Now that certainly sounds a little bit reminiscent of my experience of preschool and kindergarten. And Jesus says, you really don't know what you're asking. You really do not understand. Let me try and help you understand what this means. We are different. We are not as the Gentiles. We are not as the rulers of this world. We are forming a very different kind of community, one that's based on sacrifice and service and love. This is a different way of being. And we too, I think, sometimes misunderstand the kingdom of God. Our context is pretty rough and rugged right now. I don't know about you, but I find the headlines an absolute exercise in hanging on to hope despite the darkness, despite the conflict. This morning's New York Times front page, big picture, January 6th. We know what that meant. The front page of the Washington Post, you can tell I only got to the front page. Someone giving, intubating a COVID patient. But this is our context. And when we ask to be part of the kingdom of God, as we do by coming together, what is it we're asking? We're really asking for God's grace to support us, to help us to hold on to that hope which Christ gave us, so that we can live in our context as a witness to another way. Christians, believers in Jesus, are called to live in a way that is different. We learn about serving one another. Giving as well as receiving, receiving as well as giving, and as often offering love to those who are loveless. What is the measure of a great community? How we treat the most vulnerable. And Jesus is saying to his disciples, this is the kingdom I'm calling you to. This is the kingdom you were asking to be a part of. This is a kingdom of love. Our presiding bishop never tires of talking of love. You've heard him. It's wonderful. And it's clear. It's a clear message. But to be part of that kingdom, we have to make some sacrifices. We have to get up and come here on Sunday morning. That's pretty important. I believe everything begins with our worship. And then we go forward from here. To live in a world that quite honestly needs us, and needs the witness that we can offer of peace and love and hope and care. And this is the season when we begin to think about our community and, you know, how do we make it all hang together? What else do we bring? We bring our resources to this so that we can be together. That's otherwise known as money. And, you know, it may seem a little strange, but the kingdom of God requires all of us to pitch in whatever we can to be who we are called to be. And that is not an easy task. And so this morning you'll hear some wonderful words of stewardship. You'll see our fabulous bell people give us a very wonderful offering this morning. All of this brings us together and helps us to ponder once again what it means to be followers of Jesus Christ. Amen. I invite us now to stand as we are able. profess our faith in the words of the Creed. We believe in one God,
the Father, the Almighty, the Creator of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified at Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
In peace we pray to you, Lord God, for all people in their daily life and work. For this community, the nation, and the world. For the just and proper use of your creation. For all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble. For the peace and unity of the Church of God. For Justin, Archbishop of Canterbury, Michael, our presiding bishop, Susan, Jennifer, and Porter, our bishops, Beth, our rector, Rosemary, our celebrant, Amanda, our seminarian, and for all bishops and other ministers. For the special needs and concerns of this congregation, especially the Diocesan Search Committee, that they may be empowered and nurtured with discerning minds as we seek to elect a new bishop. This morning I ask your prayers for those missionaries and their families who have been kidnapped in Haiti. Hear us, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life. We will exalt you, O God, our King. We pray for all who have died, that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom. Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them. O God of infinite mercy, we live in a land where the negative evils were removed, often by force, from the bountiful lands they inhabited to places of desolation. Help us to support them now as they seek to retain their rich native cultures. Open our eyes to the poverty and despair that so often accompany them through life, and give us the courage and will to change the systems that perpetuate injustice for the sake of your Son, our Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. Raise our sins, now and now. Things done and left undone. So uphold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in the newness of life. to the honor and glory of Jesus Christ our Lord. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Peace of the Lord be always with you. And now I invite our vestry person. Do you have a vestry person now? Move straight to stewardship. Oh, John! There you are.
I'd like to thank Dave first for his work in Clubfield.
You're welcome.
Remind everyone that Rosemary is on the third and serious person that after the service at Cemetery. They will be the kickoff meeting for the stewardship campaign. Dan,
thank you. Good morning. I am your new chair of the stewardship committee starting this year, and I'd just like to talk to you a little bit this morning about our stewardship campaign, which we are kicking off today. So stewardship campaign is the time of year where you're really invited to make a pledge, where you tell St. Michael's how much you intend to be donating to St. Michael's in the coming year. And a pledge is really just that. It's a pledge. It's a promise. It's not this legal contract. It's legally binding, and people are going to come after you. If your situation changes, it's okay for you to change your pledge accordingly. But the important thing to consider about a pledge is that it is what the vestry uses once we have all the pledges in order to understand what the income is going to be for the following year so that they can just make the plans for the entire following year. And Beth Abington, our treasurer, is going to talk a little bit about that and the role pledges take.
So when Caroline and Dan asked me to help be part of the stewardship campaign, I had a few days or a week where I really struggled to find out the theme, new and exciting and different way to explain, demonstrate how important pledging is to St. Michael's. Luckily, I was listening to the Classical WETA just had their fund drive, and something with the radio personality says, aha, that's my theme for this one. So the theme is, what is the cost, that's the capital C, of gathering here today on Sunday for worship and for fellowship? So God's love is free, but running a church is not, especially not on Sunday. So as being on the finance committee and the treasurer, every month we get to look at the expenses that for the church. And most of those expenses that we see would not register on the Richter scale of spiritual fulfillments. Maintaining our elevator is not very transcendent. Neither is paying our insurance or our utility bill. But these are must pay, must do expenses that we have to account for every year when we're developing that mission spend plan. Now, there are gratifying expenses that we see go out through. For the St. Michael's checking account, and that's the outreach payments and the TriMont scholarships and hospitality expenses. So there is good there as well, but it really is a relatively small portion of the expenses. So, as part of talking about the cost of us getting together, I pulled together some data. And I'm going to be talking to the TV screen up here, but in your pews, there's a copy of this table if you want to. Okay. So what we're looking at here is the past 5 years of our mission spend plan accounts. Now, I didn't include any of our designated funds, our restricted funds, because those vary from year to year, and I'm just going to compare apples to apples. Just mission spend plan. And one thing, I've only got 4 years of experience working with St. Michael's finances, but I'm lucky enough to be working with people who have many more years than that. And based upon conversations that we've had over the years, 2017 and 2019 are the typical years for St. Michael's. The other 3 years are not. And we'll talk more about that in a bit. So I've broken up our transactions, our expenses, into must-do expenses, and that's the orange sections of the bar. And those are things like parish administration, buildings and grounds, salaries and benefits. And then at the very top, the yellow section is the want-to expenses. So that's mission and outreach, parish activities, and Christian education. Now, the maroon bar at the very top shows our total income for that year, and just mission spend planning income. And then the green bar below that is what we received in pledges, the pledge part of that income. So one thing to notice is that there's not a ton of daylight in between our total income and our pledge income. It's just another demonstration that pledges make up most of our income, demonstrates their importance. The next thing to notice is that our pledge income for our normal years hits right at the border between our must-do expenses and our want-to expenses. In the case of 2018, it doesn't even make it that far. It's down the road. So this is, again, just demonstrating how pledges help us pay for those must-do things that we need to take care of. Now, before I read this graph, I feel like I need to explain 2016 and 2020 show our total income as being greater than our total expenses for those years. 2020 includes $39,000 of the payroll protection program loan that we took out when everything was shut down, and we wanted to make sure we could pay our staff. And then ultimately that loan was forgiven. So we don't typically have almost $40,000 that comes to us as income. And then 2016 also had a $23,000 of a surplus from 2015 that rolled over as income. So again, that's not something that my understanding that you can see over there. Okay, so after looking at this data, I thought, okay, I'm going to focus on the must-do expenses, because those are things we have to do to figure out what is the cost of gathering together every week. Because while the church is used during the week, most of the activities are focused on getting together on Sunday so we can worship together. So based upon that, the cost of getting together on Sunday for my must-do expenses is in between $4,500 and $5,300 a Sunday. Thank you.
Oh, thank you, Beth. I hope that this helps you see how important your pledges are. So as the stewardship committee, we were thinking about what it is we need to ask you as far as pledging goes. And you might remember that last year we asked for a really large increase because we had to replace the roof. That was going on at the same time, I believe, that our pledge campaign was going on, and we knew we had to do work over at the rectory. So we put the request out there for big donations, and it was amazing, the response from the congregation. We ended up, I'm sorry, can you hear me? So we ended up having an amazing response from the congregation. Lots of donations were made, and we had the endowment that we were able to dip into. And we also took out loans in order to cover these unexpected expenses. This year, at this point, we're looking at, okay, we've got this endowment that we drew from. We should maybe consider replenishing this endowment. And we also have these loans that we need to be paying back. But at the same time, we want to be able to continue our outreach program. And so we're like, well, should we ask for a big increase again? But you know, last year, we asked for a big increase. And I think the year before that, we had asked for a pretty significant increase. And it just didn't really feel right to be asking for another big increase a third year in a row. So we're like, let's just sort of, you know, maintain the course that we're at right now. But we have to account for inflation so that we can just stay where we are. And so we looked up the inflation rate, and as of the end of August, it's 5.3%. And so that's the target that we're looking for, is just to stay where we are now by keeping up with inflation. So I know that might sound like another big ask again this year, but please just prayerfully consider what you can do. So we sent out in the mail earlier this week the stewardship packet. So you should have received your stewardship packet a couple of days ago. And if you didn't get a pledge card in the mail, please let me know. We'll make sure to get that pledge card to you. We are finishing the campaign on Sunday, November 14th. So please get the pledge cards back to us by then, because the vestry really needs that information so that they are able to plan for the following year. I think that's basically it. Thank you very much for your time this morning, and thank you for your generosity in the past, and thank you in advance for your generosity going forward. Thanks.
Well, good morning. As you've probably noticed, there's something different in the chancel this morning. Today, we're going to have our first sort of 10 o'clock performance of the rather officially named the St. Michael's Bell Choir, these six folks who've been working together to play some music for you today. And I am stopping to talk to you about it first because there's also an element that is, in fact, sort of related to what we were just discussing, which is one of the things that we're doing this year, thanks to the help and cooperation of the vestries, along with the very generous donation. We are actually refurbishing the St. Michael's bells here in just a few weeks. So what you'll be hearing today is the sort of pre-refurbishment version. We purchased these, I think that somebody could correct me, I think the year was like 1988 or something like that. And since then, they have not had professional maintenance since then. And if you're counting, that's a lot of years. That's a lot of years. So fortunately, this year we're sending them off. We just got all the stuff that we need to do that. So listen to them today, enjoy them. But if you hear a little sort of extra note here and there, or maybe it sounds like a note should have sounded, but it didn't, that's actually because of this reason. There are parts that make them less easy to play, but fortunately we'll be able to do that. Even so, these folks have done a really wonderful job getting this music together today. So we'll do that as our musical offering before we move on to spiritual communion.
Thank you, Lord, that was lovely. And now let us walk in love as Christ has loved us and given himself as an offering and sacrifice to God. We continue with our Eucharistic prayer to spiritual communion. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
We give thanks to the Lord. It is right and good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For you are the source of light and life. You made us in your image and called us to new life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in order. And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country, where with Mary the God-bearer and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters, through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Let us pray together using the words Jesus taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom and the power forever.
Alleluia, Christ, our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Alleluia.
Now together let us pray our prayer of spiritual communion. God of love, we thank you for bringing us together in this place on this day to honor and to celebrate you and your people, living, loving, body. Jesus told his disciples, whenever two or three are gathered in my name, I bless this gathering as a sacramental rite, a visible sign of your love for us and our love for one another. Even in the absence of the bread and the water, let us feed on you, your Son, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit in our hearts, with faith and peace. We offer our post-communion prayer. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with the spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen. We have worshipped God. Let us now move into God's world as a servant people, servants of God's word and servants in God's world. May God grant us the grace to hear what we are called to be and do. And may the blessing of the Most Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with you on your journey. Amen. Serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.